My name is Greg Holgate, and I am the president and CEO of Oscar Wellness. We are a Carlsbad, North County, San Diego, California-based company, proudly making the Oscar Pulse. The Oscar Pulse is a one-touch, non-drug pain relief solution. We are helping people get off opioids, narcotics, and get back to active living without the use of drugs or other interventions. Please come on by and visit us at oscarwellness.com.
We've got a very interesting panel today where we're talking about fitness devices that go beyond just tracking fitness, but also help people get well, stay well, predict health states and so on, and how we're going to talk about how they're working with other companies to affect change. You know, I remember 10 years ago, I was given a device by Philips, a wearable device that tracked my steps and a gait and so on, and connected to my Mac. And I showed it to a friend of mine, and she liked it so much she bought 10 of them for her friends. Well, you can imagine, within a few months, nobody used it. Mine went into the closet. I found it the other day, actually on my desk. I went to the website, it doesn't work anymore. How do we prevent, you know, when we've had our preview discussion, we talked about all your products, and they're all very intriguing, but how do we prevent this exhaustion that people typically find when they have new devices? At first they're very novel, everyone's excited, and then everyone loses, or many lose interest. What do you all think that you're doing that's going to prevent that from happening with your products?
Well, we found out two things.
This is a WD.
Yeah, hi, right? Everybody.
And he's the CEO of a company called Sensoria.
Right, yes. Yeah. So we found out two things. One is the fact that it's very hard to change human behavior, right? So, but we are creatures of habit. We all wake up in the morning, we take a shower, we put our clothes on, right? So by injecting technology into something that consumers, before they become patients, and unfortunately for all of us, knock on wood, but we all become patients from time to time, right, is very helpful, right? So I don't have to remember to wear anything new. It's part of my workflow. So that is number one. Number two is, what type of information we provide the consumer or the patient, right? And that appetite, the consumer appetite for data is very, very low. So even actionable information, which we talked about in the past, is not sufficient. We tend to refer to this as wisdom right now. We need to get to a point where we distill out the wisdom from the data and make it so relevant and meaningful and personal that it becomes sticky, right? So those are the two things.
And do you think you're doing that now?
We're not there yet. We're really, really working hard to make that.
I think you better tell the audience what you actually do.
Oh, yeah, sure. So what we do is we build a platform that allows consumers and patients to wear garments and footwear And by just simply connecting that garment or footwear to the internet, we call it Internet of Me instead of Internet of Things, you actually get meaningful data. So we have created a device, you've seen the video, it's a very simple device, super small, super light, it's 8 grams, that can actually be connected to any piece of footwear or garment, shoes like the ones I'm wearing, or a diabetic, in this case, this is a diabetic cam boot. The same device can actually be connected to pretty much any type of device that has not just the sensors embedded into the device itself, but sensors physically infused in the footwear and the garment. So that's what we do.
So you say that you're not quite there yet.
No.
What do you need to do?
Well, there are challenges in our industry, primarily due to cost, battery life, and also to the fact that there are two components. There's a consumer component and there's a brand component, right? The consumer, we keep talking about the consumer and the patient and the meaningful stickiness of the data to the patient or the consumer. But we also have to remember that there's a fantastic opportunity for the brands that actually create these products to get meaningful intimacy with their customers by understanding how their products are utilized. And right now, most brands are in the dark. When it comes to that, right? I can buy a pair of running shoes and go to the office with them, or I can be an ultra-marathon runner and run 100 miles with those shoes. The brand knows absolutely nothing about what I do with that product. I can be a skier that goes skiing with my family once a year for 5 days, or I can live in Aspen and ski 4 days a week. I can buy ski boots, but those ski boots, the brand that actually builds those ski boots knows absolutely nothing about me as a skier. Think about the opportunity of just to upsell, cross-sell the consumer in a smarter, more intimate, more personal way. It's just not there right now.
So thinking about that opportunity, are the producers of these products interested in gathering this data?
Absolutely.
Talking to them.
Now, finally, these brands and these products, medical devices like what I showed you, this is an FDA clear medical device, and brands, sports brands alike, now understand the importance of data. Right, and it's actually, it's going to happen. They're all appointing people that are IoT, digital data people that can go beyond social media, right? The engagement right now is primarily social media for brands, right? When it comes to direct. But if they want to shift their revenues from channel to consumer, channel to direct consumer, they have to understand the consumer, not the channel anymore. Before, it was all about the channel, right? And with Amazon being as successful as it is, the channel is either going away or Amazon is becoming the channel. So better, the rest of the revenues has to come from direct to consumer. How can you engage the consumer if you have no clue about what the consumer does with your products?
Charles, you've got, a particularly challenging situation with your product. By the way, this is Charles O'Connell, who is the CEO of FitnessTech.
What's up, guys?
You're working with people who have diabetes.
Yes.
People who have diabetes are often said to not be as compliant as they need to be in medication and doing exercise and so on. So aren't you then challenged with people using your product and continuing to use it on a regular basis in order to help their health?
Yes, so it's a great, great question and topic. And you know, the difference between a toy and a tool is relevance.
Right.
You know, that's number one. When you're talking specifically about the diabetic population, people living with diabetes rely on data every single day to literally maintain their life. And if you ask a person living with diabetes how important their glucose meter is, they will tell you it's of life importance. Okay. There's a big, big falsehood out there that people with diabetes are lazy, that's why they're not compliant. Okay. That could not be farther from the truth. People with diabetes are too busy. They're caretakers, they're parents, they are professionals. And they're having trouble taking care of themselves. Another big kind of misunderstanding in in talking specifically about diabetes is everybody knows that exercise is good for diabetes. What's not understood is that exercise is fundamentally different for people living with diabetes, starting with the need to test their blood sugar. And that data is of extreme relevance. Depending on what their blood sugar level is, it may or may not be safe to exercise. It may or may not be safe to perform certain types of exercise.
So it's not just different for people who have diabetes, but it's different within the diabetes population.
Yes, exactly, within the diabetic population. Now, let's talk about somebody who has neuropathy. That's something of extreme importance, okay? And what our goal with GlucoZone is to create a platform where information from wearable devices and just literally Davide's footwear product, okay? For a person that's at risk for neuropathy, all of a sudden hearing from their foot becomes extremely relevant. Like, as in like, I'm gonna be checking in on this information every single day. Our goal with GlucoZone is then to create the relevance for that data, to basically create easy to use warning systems and algorithms that can take data from a device that's monitoring a person's walking or their foot care, take data from an insulin pump, take data from a heart rate monitor, take data from a CGM and create relevance for it. What the problem is right now is everybody's big data, oh, data. But when you just dump data on people, it's totally overwhelming. That data has to be put into context. So if I test my blood sugar and I'm rushing to get to the Venetian and my blood sugar is 205, just that number alone doesn't mean anything. But if it's in the context of the medication that I've taken, it's in the context of the time of day, it's in the context of what my Apple Watch says my heart rate is right now, now all of a sudden that data now becomes actionable. And you know, our goal with GlucoZone is basically to inform people, to give them a heads up, hey, this combination of insulin on board, glucose level of this, heart rate level of this, puts you potentially in a place that you may need to be careful. Here's a warning, maybe it is time to have a snack, or maybe it's not, you know? So in my opinion, the use of data and what we're trying to do with GlucoZone is to really create relevance, correlate the data, create relevance. And in our particular case with the diabetic population, people living with diabetes are at the forefront of wearable devices. People with type 1 diabetes are like the original wearable device gangsters. Okay, they've been wearing wearable devices for 20 years. You know,
So you've got an app that aggregates data from lots of different sources and then gives information and suggestions. And
based on that real-time data.
And what products are you aggregating data from?
We are aggregating data from CGMs, from glucose meters, from heart rate monitors, from the Internet of Things, okay? Hydration monitors, Fitbits that are tracking your steps, okay? We are just at the forefront of the collection of all this incredible biometric data. In the case of diabetes, every single one of those points of data has relevance to my blood sugar level. Okay? But if you just dump the data on the person, they're not really going to be able to use it. Nobody wants a math equation. People want to know, what do I do?
So, do you have any data that proves that the efficacy of your work?
In other words, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the proof. So here's the thing. Everybody knows exercise is good for diabetes. We don't need to prove that. In our particular case with GlucoZone, we did conduct a clinical pilot where basically working with Yale New Haven Health Systems, Yale New Haven Health identified patients with type 2 diabetes who had A1C levels above 7.5 and were all candidates for pharmaceutical escalation. according to the standard management protocol, okay? And they also had a history of not having success with exercise. And what we did was, instead of pharmaceutically escalating, they came and did our glucosone program instead, which was exercise solutions based on their real-time glucose levels. And here's why that's so important. You can have a person that's taking Victoza, Levemir, and Farxiga, same dosages every day. One day when they go to the gym, their glucose level is 200. The very next day, same medication profile, their glucose level is 100. That right there is a different solution scenario. And that's what glucosone does. It takes that information, correlates it in real time, and then informs the person, here's the exercise solution that most likely is gonna have, help you have success. And we had a phenomenal, phenomenal result with that group of patients. So average A1C improvement of over 2 points. Average weight loss of 10 pounds because we were arming the population with guidance from this data. And the reality is the average diabetic patient is on 6 different medications. That is not, you know, you can't just tell somebody with diabetes go for a walk. You can't just hand them a Fitbit, an insulin pump, a CGM, a glucose meter, and expect them to figure it out.
So you're really talking about very personalized medicine here.
Yes.
Which is obviously a big trend that I'm sure we're all familiar with. And Jonathan Pally is the CEO of a company called Spire, and you also are challenged or faced with the challenge of making sure that people continue to use what essentially are passive devices that your company manufactures.
Yeah, so we think of...
So tell us, by the way, help people understand what you do now and what you're going to be doing.
Absolutely.
Shortly.
So the core of Spire is continuous respiration sensing. We are really the only ones out there that are able to accurately measure respiratory patterns throughout the day at night. And that has a number of different applications across the health field. We are probably, at this point, most known for a product we've had in the market for a couple years that's fairly widely sold in the behavioral health and mental well-being space. We're looking at measuring respiratory patterns to look for chronic stress and anxiety from panic attacks, and making the user aware of that often ahead before they might be consciously aware and therefore preventing these kinds of exacerbations or episodes. And to go back to what you were saying, as we look at the success of our products and then also the challenges, we see basically two key ideas. The first one is the products have to drive towards outcomes. So the products, the data, the whatever you call it, ultimately it's about outcomes. People are engaged in products that deliver outcomes to them that they care about. And that might be to prevent, you know, the downsides of unmanaged diabetes. And you know, one product that we sell that's in preventing, you know, chronic anxiety from overtaking your life, for example. And so that's one key thing. And the other aspect of these devices is around what we like to think of, and it's what you were mentioning, as friction, right? If there's an equation, if the friction is too high and the outcomes it drives for me are too low, then you get that engagement drop off, right? If the friction is low enough and the outcomes are high enough, then you don't have that engagement. We see that in our data just very, very clearly. The challenge is that for a lot of things, you can drive towards very clear outcomes, but you're not necessarily able to deliver those outcomes every single day. So for example, in the behavioral health space, someone's not necessarily having a panic attack every single day, right? When you start looking at sleep and insomnia, they may not be having trouble sleeping every single day. And so how do you create, in the world we live in, where people have very short attention spans, and we expect instant gratification, how do we create products that are able to collect enough data so we can drive to those outcomes, even when it's not, oh, I put this on and I immediately feel better. And so our solution, I think, like Sensoria was saying, okay, let's make sure the experience, let's make sure the goal is driven towards outcomes, but let's make sure the experience of actually wearing these devices, of collecting data, is as low friction as possible. And the solution for us, and this is something that we're basically just announced and are talking about, is around making it part of your clothes. We all wear clothes, that's behavior that's unlikely to change. And so we looked at that and said, just like you did with socks, and said, well, if we can make it just wear the clothes that you already wear, then the friction has gone to zero.
So right now that's not the case with your current product is more than obvious.
Our previous product, yes. We've got to flip it on it.
You're not going to be selling that anymore.
We will keep selling it, but one of our products, our first generation product, okay. I should say more specifically. But our new product is this Aspire tag, which looks like this. You can see some demos downstairs. And this is just a little tag that we sell in packs, and you just stick it onto the clothing you wear most often. So for most people, that's like underwear or bras. And then you just forget about it. The battery lasts a year and a half. It goes to the washer and dryer. So once you put this on once, you literally never have to think about wearing our device again. And so there's the friction's gone to zero. I mean, I obviously have a device on right now. I just open my suitcase and put on my clothes. I never thought about it this morning. So the friction's down to zero. And then our app experience, what we do with the data, the respiratory data, this is heart rate, and it's got activity, so it's got kind of everything you'd expect, plus the respiration. What we do with that data is then have the user go in and say, this is what I care about. I care about better managing my stress. I care about sleeping better at night. We're working with partners on, I care about managing my COPD or asthma, for example. So going in and saying what I care about, and then making sure the experience drives them.
So you don't expect people then to look at the data on a daily basis, but more to get warnings when things are...
Our view is, the reality is, we don't want to think about our health daily. I think we get, we're in the field, we're like, people want to care about it. They don't, right? People want to go about their lives. They don't want to think about it, and particularly if you're not healthy. You really don't want to think about it, right? And so our view is, as product developers, our job is to make the product disappear, both from a perspective of the actual physical product as well as the app experience. And so, our app is designed towards not interrupting you until we have something very relevant to say that is actionable, that you can act on and actually improve whatever you care about.
Yeah, I think that relevancy clearly is very important. It reminds me of the old Beatles movie Help, when one spy told the other spy, now report back to me on everything you're doing. And he says, okay, I'm now moving my right foot, I'm now moving my left foot. And I think that's often happened with a lot of the data aggregation products that we're seeing. People are looking at these things and seeing what they're doing on a minute-by-minute basis for 3 days, and then they get tired of doing it. Charles, one thing you said, that people who have diabetes are very interested in monitoring their health. Yeah, of course, there's still a subset of people who are in denial and don't want to look at any of that stuff. I've anecdotally known many people with diabetes like that who never check their blood sugar level because they hope it'll go away if they don't check it.
We call that the ostrich strategy. Usually the reason why people become ostriches is they don't know what to do with the data. It's very frustrating. If you have diabetes and you're testing your blood sugar, one day it's 260, the other day it's 120, and you don't know why that's happening and you don't have a solution to address either one of those, then you release your emotional attachment to the information. And when you become emotionally detached from the data, then it's easy to not care. If I don't care about what the data says, then it doesn't matter if it's 260 or 120, or if I'm stressed out. I don't care.
Right.
And so, in my experience, I have never met a person living with diabetes who wanted to have uncontrolled diabetes. I have met many people who didn't know what to do about it. And that's, why people stop testing their blood sugar.
Yeah. Greg, this is Greg Holgate, our last speaker. You've got a product, though, that is not that unobtrusive compared to your colleagues. It's a little more using it. Why don't you tell us about it?
Sure. So, Oscar Wellness is a maker of the Oscar Pulse. We are, I don't know if anyone's familiar with us, but we won the TechCo Startup of the Year for a couple reasons. We're delivering a non-invasive, non-drug pain relief solution. So it's based on a very long-standing history of using pulsed electric magnetic frequency to reduce inflammation and pain at a cellular level. So it's totally non-invasive. The interesting thing is, and to your original question, Eric, is how do you keep your product relevant and continue to people so it doesn't become, you know, a bookmark inside your office. So if you are addressing a problem, and technology should be used to address a problem, and I think everybody on the stage here is really focused on that. So it's encouraging for me to be at CES and hear the solution sets that are coming out. But if you are addressing someone's core problem, and pain, by the way, is a 1 in 3 Americans suffer from chronic pain. And we're dealing with drugs and shots and other therapies, but nobody's offering solutions that are non-invasive. So we're monitoring things and we're providing data sets to help people move forward. But if you deliver a technology that solves a real problem that allows people to get out and go activate their day, so if you're giving them better information so that their blood sugar levels are not impacting their day to be healthy, or you're measuring vital statistics that allow them to get out and do things, which is what we do. So we put the power of controlling your pain in the palm of your hand. And you can wear it anywhere on your body, so it doesn't have to be on your skin, it doesn't, you know, it doesn't vibrate so it just shocks through your body, or it doesn't have to be on a sticky pad, or it doesn't have to be, it can be anywhere. In fact, the field is so big, it actually can be near you. So we have people that have carpal tunnel that have it next to their hand while they're using their mouse, and they're getting the benefit of that. So really important to have relevant technology the way everyone has described it here, but more importantly that it's non-invasive or frictionless. And that's a challenge. And if it's frictionless and then your day improves, then you're gonna adopt it. And once you've adopted it, guess what? Now you have an advocate. If you have an advocate, the advocate for, in our case, has been a consumer who's crossed over as a patient, who's now out telling other patients, this is a non-invasive way to deal with your pain. So we've developed an app that we introduced today that will be able to allow people to better control and manage their pain by monitoring their pain levels during their day.
Why do you need an app? I mean, don't you know when your pain goes away?
So what's interesting is, so what happens is, you go to the doctor, and you walk in, you go, hey, I got a neck pain, and he asks, how are you feeling today, Eric? And you go, I'm an 8. Well, guess what? 8 is unmanageable. So he's immediately going to prescribe you drugs, or he's going to get you a shot, or he's going to get you some immediate invasive therapy. But if you have this, and you put it on, and 30 minutes later you go, I'm a 6, you just reduced your pain threshold significantly, and your 8 and my 8 are very different.
Right.
So it's really important, and personalized medicine, which everyone here is focused on, is that we have to be able to, that relevant technology dealing with that problem has to become personal. If it doesn't become personal, then you're not going to adopt it. And so the app is important in the fact that it's allowing people to take control of their pain and understand it so that they can move through it and move on to their next activity in their life.
So in addition to allowing you to easily monitor your changing pain levels, does the app have other functionality?
Yeah, it has other, it will encourage you to do other activities. Very similar to the things that you're hearing on the stage, which is that ecosystem of a day in the life of a person, right? So it'll encourage you, hey, by the way, how are you feeling today? If you got out for your walk, it's got activity management, all those kinds of things are there, which we're all trying to inspire other people that are dealing with these conditions to get out and move, right?
Why is it blue, by the way?
Well, blue for a reason. So quite frankly, medical devices are typically white boxes or gray, and this is actually a class 1 medical device, which is registered with the FDA, and it's quite appealing. So people like blue. Blue is very soothing. So you do the studies, you look at colors, and we went out and checked with people what they liked. Blue is a very soothing color. So our new line will have multiple colors because people that have chronic pain like fibromyalgia want a purple skin because fibromyalgia is purple is the color of choice, or CRPS-RSD, or chronic pain is a kind of an orangish-yellow color. So we're making that available so people can personalize because they want it personal. And once they become personal, they go out and they share. And if they share, we help everybody, which is, I think, really a real big benefit of listening to you guys.
Besides being much better looking, how is it different from a tension?
So there's no electrodes, no cables, doesn't have to be on your skin.
TENS machine basically blocks pain, but once the signal is away, the nerve tissue actually will come back and it'll cause pain again. Where this will actually reduce inflammation at the cellular level by increasing circulation and then pushing out any kind of waste product in the cell and allowing nutrients to come back into the cell quicker.
Okay. So I presume that many of you on this panel would like to work with healthcare providers or perhaps independent living homes and so on. Are you doing that now, which is a chance for everybody to speak whenever you wish? And what obstacles or challenges or perhaps none, what successes are you finding doing it?
We are. I can't say who. I can't name the names, unfortunately, which I realize.
Why not?
Confidentiality. So a lot, I think you have past challenges, you know, healthcare goes slower than the consumer space. And so our strategy has been, which has been successful so far, is work with very large partners in the healthcare space. And you know, that takes years. We're doing clinical trials, we're doing product development with them. That takes, you know, a number of years. And so we use the consumer space as a way to generate revenue. We use the consumer space as a way to collect data and improve our products. You know, so the fact that we have, you know, tens of thousands of these devices on people every day allows us to collect tons of data, which allows us to continue to improve our algorithms, which allows us in turn to better serve our large medical partners. But the reality is we're still, I guess, young enough, you could say, where those medical partnerships have not come into, not fully commercialized yet, and so it's not public. That's the first thing. I'll say the other thing, and this is something that you mentioned as well. Interestingly enough, with our consumer products, our biggest referrer is medical professionals. Now, we don't market to them, so we're not an FDA-cleared device, but success that patients have, for example, with our first product in the mental health space, patients go into the Apple store, they buy our product, they have success with it. They go and tell their healthcare professional, hey, I'm having a lot of success with this, you know, you take less drugs, what have you. That health professional then, you know, we sometimes they'll reach back to us and be like, oh, I heard about your product from this patient. You know, where's the clinical proof? Unfortunately, we have that, we sent it to them. But then they start recommending it to other patients and we're then going and buying on Amazon or Apple or what have you. And so I think on the two sides, one is the traditional health space, we certainly have partnerships and are building that. But even on the consumer space, I think we're seeing this shift from consumers just kind of going and buying these devices because they're cool, to healthcare professionals more and more saying, what are digital solutions that I can recommend, maybe not prescribe, but recommend to my patients that are going to create, that I believe are going to create outcomes. And then those patients are going to consumer channels to buy them. And that's something that we're seeing, you know, continue to grow.
What do you see? Well, for Sensoria, so we have the pain, I wish I had a good place, and benefit of starting very early on a journey towards frictionless, transparent computing, which we refer to that in, you know, when we started the company. So we had the vision of Sensoria in late 2010. We started the company in 2011, when it was quite frankly technically unreasonable to think about frictionless transparent computing. Right, putting sensors into garments at that time, when, you know, quite frankly, some of the devices that we were referring to before were less than wearable. Actually, some of these devices were embarrassing and referred to as a stigma. I don't want to be wearing a medical device. I don't want to be seen wearing a pendant with my focus group. People refer to pendants as the dead button. The dead button. And we all know this, right? Because, you know, we're not, you know, one of the larger organizations out there. I'm sure they're running focus groups. They know that people don't want to be seen wearing these devices, right? So we need to take the devices away. The device needs to disappear to the human eye into something that we are proud and happy to wear, because we communicate with wear. That's how we, one of the ways that we communicate. So injecting sensing into garments is probably the easiest socially acceptable thing to do. Other devices will come, right? Injected devices or tattoos and things like that. Those are even further out, right? But so as a geek, we need to figure out how to solve real problems with the technology that we have that will become available very soon. And so garments and footwear is we think, meaningful and potentially impactful. I can make names, so you ask for names. We're starting a new journey and a new company with the largest post-acute healthcare provider in the country. The name is Genesis Healthcare. They own 450, over 450, I guess, skilled nursing and assisted living facilities. They're fully owned subsidiary Genesis Rehab Services, employs 17,000 physical therapists. They touch 55,000 patients per day. Talking about frictionless computing, we need to figure out a way to inject human beings in the middle of a very hard workflow, right? If we want to increase stickiness of these devices, having a PT physically telling a patient, John, you probably need to wear this, right? It's good for you if you have, you know, yes, you probably have to, you know, use this bra or this t-shirt or recharge it again from time to time, unfortunately for now. But it's going to be good for you, right? Because we can monitor your compliance to rehab, because we can monitor your peripheral neuropathy challenged foot before you go into an amputation. And there are some conversations like this that we don't like to have, but unfortunately we have to have. And you switch on the TV and you get, you know, debates on meaningless stuff when every 30 seconds, it's 2018, a limb is lost to diabetes. It's medieval that in this country, 90,000 amputations due to diabetes happened last year, right? It shouldn't be that way. We just need to remove, to replace the nerve sensation of these people with something that tells them, using John, you're not doing something great. You probably need to keep this device on. That's good for you. Don't take it off because it helps offload, mechanically offload your diabetic foot ulcer, which is a wound under your foot. These people don't feel their feet, I agree. They're not undisciplined. They just don't have the same nerve sensation that we do. Normal people are lucky enough, because it's just luck, to have,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, so we have those same patient populations. We have quite a bit of diabetic patients and consumers that come and use our product and get massive benefit. But to your question about our healthcare providers partnering with them, yeah, absolutely. We did a clinical trial at Scripps La Jolla, randomized double-blind placebo study, and the data was amazing. It's being published this month in the Practical Pain Management, which will go to 60,000 pain doctors' offices. So it's really more about time and frequency of message for us. People are still married to devices. They still need to know something's there. So I love the fact that we've got things that are getting embedded or are working that way, and I think ultimately that's what we're gonna get, but it's iterative. I think that consumer behavior, patient behavior still needs to feel that something's there that they can latch onto. So brand is important to recognize that that's happening. It's just like when you walk in a doctor's office and they give you a smock. Well, the smock's got the name of that healthcare, so St. Jude's. Well, guess what? There's trust with that brand. That's why they go to St. Jude's or they go to Scripps. So it's the same thing with the devices. So we found healthcare partners in workers' comp insurance companies, to insurance companies, to medical trades, and doctor's offices that are doing physiotherapy, to orthopedic, to pain. And so, you know, happy to share all their names, but the reality is they're adopting technology that's helping their patient, because ultimately they're graded on patient outcome. And I've spent the last 10 years in orthopedics, and it's all about the patient outcome. So someone has a knee surgery, well, after this knee surgery, if they're not ambulatory and hitting certain benchmarks by week 2, 4, and 6, guess what? They're not getting reimbursement. So it's a pay-to-play process. And if anybody understands that, then you have to behave inside that. Until we change that system or improve it, we have to understand that. So devices that are running aside of that or technologies running aside of that are not gonna be players down the line. And so I think it's really important for us to do that.
I totally agree. You just totally nailed it. And we're working with ACOs. I think that's a really important point. The accountable care organizations now having financial responsibility for population management. But we are taking a different approach. We are very clear that the paradigm has shifted from provider-centric information, disbursement of information, to patient-centric solutions. And the patient is finding it through their phone. Okay, that's just straight up behavior. Okay? The patient is expecting the information to be on their phone. And yet we are communicating that our product is available, but quite frankly for us, the diabetic population globally is 640 million. In America, it's 30 million. And we have done zero marketing. We just, we just crossed 1 million users on our YouTube channel with an average of 9 minutes per view. They find us. We haven't gone to find them. And that tells us, you know what? The future in terms of getting your product out is utilizing social media platforms, being very effective with things like YouTube, because that's human behavior. When somebody leaves the doctor's office and the doctor said, you're at risk for diabetic neuropathy, you need to go get some exercise, guess what they're gonna do? On YouTube, how do I exercise with diabetic neuropathy? Bam, glucosome. Try it, taste it, feel it, do it.
Yeah, so Charles, I agree with you to a point, but there's a population of over 50, over 55, over 60 that doesn't embrace technology that way, and that population is heavily impacted by the medical system that we got, the ECOs.
Totally true.
So there's so
but
we're
our
definitely
average,
moving in that direction.
I thought that question. Our biggest user group on YouTube is over 50 years old.
It's definitely moving trendy that way. I agree with that. But hey, but you're seeing. Yeah.
Well, we go direct to the consumer.
Yeah.
We're direct to the customer, direct to the person living with diabetes. We do have relationships.
You've got to serve both populations.
For sure.
So you got to give them. You have to give them an option there. And I think until we pull them in, I sat in an interesting conversation. So all your devices and all your technologies actually work with people that have got, sight disability. They're deaf, they have difficulty in some fashion, and so everything has to work with that population as well, because it's a combination. It's not always just diabetic. They're overweight, they've got dystonia, they've got some other condition that's impacting their life. And so, yeah, they're reaching to technology. I think WebMD was a great gateway to get people to at least look for information, and now they're going to YouTube, platforms like yours that are giving that information, but you have to still give them a basic way of reaching that content. That's not necessarily web driven all the time. So I see Eric's got a pad, paper, and a pen, right? He's not using an iPad. Why? I mean, by the way, he's our core demographic. I mean, ultimately, your
I'm
generation
free, though.
Population.
I think the paradigm is shifting.
It's shifting.
I think that there's
no
a million people daily on Facebook, and they're over the age of 55.
I think one thing that we're kind of skipping over that's important to maybe highlight is this question of who pays. Because I think we certainly see, and you were talking about this, there's a move toward patients. Patients are becoming more vulnerable in healthcare, right? But they still expect the payer to pay, right? So we're becoming more patient-centric, which is great. People are doing more to find information about what they can do, WebMD, apps, etc., what they can do. I think outside of specific areas, people still largely expect that they aren't paying out of pocket, that they're paying, right? That they're paying. And in many ways, that's as device makers, that's one of the challenges that we spend a lot of time thinking about and trying to work through, and it's why I kind of hinted at how we've staged things, is because that's where the dollars are, unfortunately. That's one of the things that is, one might say messed up about the American healthcare system, but there is multiple stakeholders. And where those dollars are, where the value is not always completely aligned. That's important.
We're about to get the hook because I see we're almost 3 minutes over, but I'm wondering, since we're the last discussion of the day, if we could have a few minutes perhaps to have people ask some questions, if anyone in the audience has one or two. I see somebody back there.
How do you see the future, 2020 or 2030, goes to when medical devices go directly to the consumers? Like recently, the bill has been passed that the hearing aids can be sold directly as medical devices to the consumers, as over the counter.
So I sat on the panel yesterday where they talked about that specifically, and the CTA has been lobbying for that for quite some time. So med devices as a over-the-counter versus a prescriptive, which is exactly where we sit as a product and a company, that's coming. So the personal pay program is coming, whether you like it or not. And so insurance and payer behavior is going to have to change and adjust, and all of our health economics has to change along with it. So it's coming, so in 2020, 2030, my expectation would be that you are probably 80 to 90% responsible for the devices or care that you acquire, and less likely to be dependent on your payer to make all those decisions for you. You're gonna be making that decision.
And HSA and FSA, HSA and FSA, I think in 2020 going forward, that whole concept of basically tax-free dollars put aside that you then have the choice to spend on, I think is what's going to be actually becoming more and more relevant in the consumption of devices, apps, programs for healthcare.
I think as product makers, what that means, and certainly our belief, is that our responsibility becomes not just building devices that are accurate and deliver outcomes, but that are also user-friendly. And that's probably the thing that you see.
Yeah, everything that you guys said makes a lot of sense. I think there are two components here. One is Medicare is moving towards 80% at risk, which is true, but most of the healthcare system is still transactional in this country. And so when you think about a transactional system, at the P&L level, there are two ways. Either you make the device pay for itself, and therefore for the provider is either paid for by a payer, or it makes sense to buy it and give it away, but there's also the cost structure. So if we can figure out a better way from a product standpoint, create products that actually take away cost. Let me give you an example, falls. It's another, we haven't talked about falls, but this is another incredible problem that I don't think as technology people, we have not, again, enough focus on, right? It's the number one cause of fatal injuries in this country. It's the number one cause of non-fatal injuries in this country. $19 billion cost to the taxpayer right now. What is the solution? I can't find one. There is one on the floor. There is a decent one on the floor that I would use.
Actually, I just read an interesting work in the Netherlands where they're teaching people how to fall properly.
Yeah, I mean, we're at the point where we know people will fall, and people will always fall, but we have to teach people how to fall. But we talk about artificial intelligence and predictive analytics. Wouldn't it be nice to get to a point where in 5 years from now we get 1% less falls, 2% less falls? I mean, I can tell you, I'm looking at data of partners of ours. They have tens of thousands of falls per month in their systems. Tens of thousands of people fall. And many of them cannot be prevented, but many other falls can be prevented.
Not because there are people working on it.
Yeah. I think we should. So yeah, those I think are examples of devices.
Another question?
One last question.
Okay.
Hi. I own a chain of QSR salad restaurants. That's something we talk about a lot is how cool it would be if someone knew how different meals affected them, their sleep that day, their energy that day, their stress levels. But then they would have to input that, we can have with our loyalty card, you can find out what they ate. But then they would have to input that data about how they felt. That sounds like a lot of work. So I'm wondering, as far as partnerships go, what you guys do, what would be the next steps for that?
So if I can take that one, or you guys answer, but that's very much up the round of what we're doing right now with Spire Tag. So because this product is able to see sleep, stress and productivity and physical activity, a lot of the consumer app that we have, the wellness app, is all about connecting the dots between those three. So we're able to say, hey, you've had the last 3 nights less and less deep sleep. Tonight would be a really great night to exercise more, which tends to be correlated with
what about
food? But food, I didn't quite hear it said, but we're very interested in food as well. And so I think that kind of idea is great to be able to show. You can find the afterwards, absolutely.
We're actively, proactively working with forward-thinking food and nutrition companies that basically have the data, the nutritional data that's in their food, to easily take that information and bring it into the glucosome, so that the person who is part of the glucosome program can just very quickly indicate, I had this meal at this restaurant, and then glucosome connects with that restaurant and knows the exact nutritional data, the micro nutritional data, and can then take that information and put it into relevance in terms of their diabetic condition at that moment.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. Well, I'm afraid we are out of time, but thank you everyone for a great panel. Thanks to the audience as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.